Well, all this week we've continued our look at the first chapter of James and considering particularly the issue of God's Word and our tendency to be forgetful. We forget many times because we don't really focus adequately upon it and allow it to really have its impact upon our thought life. And in many ways, that's what a daily Bible reading does. It's really a reprogramming of the mind. This was something that I had especially experienced when I was first saved. The first about 5 years that I was a Christian, the only book I read, except for maybe a few exceptions, was actually the Bible. I read it from cover to cover, and I did it because simply I was addicted to it. I just couldn't get away from it. And even though when I first got into ministry, I believe it or not, I actually was involved in music ministry, but my passion was for God's Word, and I realized I was not talented in music enough to be able to maintain any level of competency outside of dedicating myself fully to it. And I just made a choice. I want to know the Word. I want to know the Bible. I want to study it. So that became the focus of my life, and I'm glad I did because it's really remained my passion. But, you know, you may be sitting there saying, well, that's fine for you. Your job is to teach the Bible, but what about me? And that's the problem we have many times, as James talked about, that we become like people who look in a mirror and forget what we look like. In fact, the way he puts it is this way in verse 23 of chapter 1. He said, anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Now, I find that as I get older, I tend to want to forget what I look like. I mean, you know, I look in the mirror and I just realize the years haven't been kind. And you just don't want to focus on the aging process and the damage it's doing to you. And you just kind of want to go on. But this is talking about something a little more serious because he says, here you are, you've kind of divided your life into these two sectors. You have your spiritual life, which is when you read the Bible, you go to church and you hear the word taught, and then you have the rest of your life, which is the secular life. And we've talked about this before, this dichotomous existence that many Christians have where they don't allow biblical Christianity to infect the other areas of their life by how they do business, how they interact with people, how they behave in sports or competitions or in any number of areas, particularly in the home and with the family. And the whole idea of the Word of God is it's meant to be central to your life. It's meant to be the defining characteristic of who you are. And that only happens by giving an intensity of focus. And so he says, you know, that when we look in the mirror of God's Word, what we're going to see is a reflection of who we are in light of who He is. And we begin to see that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Again, in John 3, Jesus said that men don't like to come to the light because their deeds are evil, and so they hate the light. And this is the transition that we go through as we begin to grow in our relationship with God, because we come to this place where we're saying, you know what, I desperately want to know what God has to say to me about me, even though it may not be flattering, because I know that the only way I can ever experience God's blessing in my life is by conforming my life to what His Word says. Again, how do we conform ourselves? Well, we begin there on Monday talking about how we humbly accept the Word. How do we humbly accept it? By saying, God, apply it to my life. God is responsible for the application of that truth to my life by the help of His Holy Spirit, but I have to begin with the acknowledgement that I cause something to happen in my life when I simply say, God, Your Word is truth, that I have past sins, I have present transgressions, I have things I'm going to do in the future, Lord, and I confess those to You. And I find a lot of people never really go forward in their Christian life or kind of get hamstrung because they're so ashamed or burdened by their past life that they never really want to put it on the altar and really say, Lord, I really blew it this way. This is why my life has all these hurts and pains and disappointments and frustrations, because I lived willfully, and I confess that to You and ask You to forgive me. It's that idea that we just put that away, because it's one thing to say, well, the Lord's forgiven me of the past, but it's quite a different thing to actually go to Him and say, Lord, I'm putting these things on the altar and asking You to wash and cleanse them from my life and no longer let those be defining factors of how I move forward in the future. Paul is interesting what he said to Timothy in the beginning of that first letter. He said, I am chief among sinners. And it's interesting that Paul had not forgotten his past behavior that was so reprehensible, but he refused to allow it to define him any longer, that he was defined now by his relationship with Christ. And I just ask you, friend, do you still allow yourself to be defined by your past failures, your past sins and transgressions? One of the evidences that you're doing it is how you, when we don't want to really take ownership for it, like we live with a shame and a guilt because of what we did in the past. That says to me that I've never really accepted the forgiving grace of Christ fully, that my life is no longer defined by what I once was. It no longer controls my future. Or if every time something goes wrong in your life, you begin to react by saying, oh, God's judging me and what did I do wrong? It's that sense of pervading guilt that grows out of an internalized shame that we don't want to address. Freedom comes when we bring the shame up, the things that we are horribly ashamed. And I'm not saying confess it in front of a bunch of people. I think that is often abused in very unhealthy ways. But rather that we're very open with God and saying, God, forgive me. I shouldn't have done that. I made choices without you. These are the consequences. Because one of the things I see in all the great prophets is they were really quick to repent. They were great repenters. And even people like Daniel, who had never done the things that his forefathers done, yet he confessed the sins of his forefathers and said, Father, we were shaped by these sins, and our circumstance now is the consequence of those sins. Forgive us for those past sins. I mean, that sense of owning that and giving that to God so that he can completely take it away from you is really a key to forget, to overcoming. So that when we read the word, we don't forget what we see, but we begin to really present that to God and say, God, here's what I see in myself, and I need your healing right now. God bless you and go in his grace.